everyone. Thank you so much for having me here today. My name is Vanessa Torres, and I work with C-SPAN Networks in Washington, D.C., so right just up the street. Today, we're here to celebrate some Studentcam winners. But before I begin with our ceremony, we do have a few special guests here with us today. We have your mayor here today, and she's going to say a few words to congratulate the students. We always love to invite our local and national elected officials, so we also have a staffer from Congressman Beyer's office here as well. So I'll have the mayor come up, and we will, after that, continue. So,
well, good morning. How are you? I'm Allison Silberberg. I'm the mayor of Alexandria, and I'm here to congratulate our student documentarians. Actually, you're not just student you're documentarians. This is very exciting. I love C-SPAN, I must say. Thank God for C-SPAN. There was a time when C-SPAN didn't exist, and it's hard to believe that our country survived, but it's a great gift to our country and to the world, really. But I'm really here to talk about the students, the documentarians. It's very impressive, I must say. Raise your hand if you are one of the awardees, please. Can you raise your hand? Wow. So what grade are you in? Sorry?
All seniors.
So you're ready to go.
Yeah.
Couple weeks. You're flying. So, well, congratulations for these awards. Congratulations for what's about, you're on the cusp of new challenges, and I'm sure you'll do great. I actually went to UCLA to the School of Theater, Film, and Television. So I have a master's in fine arts from that school. It's actually a master's in playwriting. But while I was there, I was able to totally diversify my degree and take tons of courses in TV and film, from directing and editing to production. And I made a short film as well that won a couple of awards. So, and I had the great honor of interning for Sidney Pollack, who's a great filmmaker of our time. Made the film Out of Africa and Tootsie and The Way We Were and other things. And then while here in Washington, I made a short film with kids in Anacostia at the height of the Crack Wars, and helping them realize their potential by using film, mentoring them. Maybe that's something that'll be of interest to you. But I really encourage you, documentary filmmaking is incredible and it's exciting. I'm a huge fan of Ken Burns and his brother Rick and David Gruben and a whole host of documentarians. Charles Guggenheim was a great filmmaker. There's a lot of documentary filmmaking that goes on right here in the DC area. In fact, this is one of the national hubs for it. I would say DC and New York are the two biggest for documentary filmmaking. And I'm thrilled to know that three of our own have won awards from C-SPAN. This is huge. So I have great expectations for you, and I want to see what you come up with as you go on with your careers. So congratulations. You make us very proud here in Alexandria. So as your mayor, thank you for all your hard work, and keep going. All right? And thank you to C-SPAN for coming to our school. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mayor, for those kind words. Good morning, everyone. My name is Jency Pinagua, and I am a second-year TV production student. And on behalf of our program, I'd like to thank all of you for coming here. Today, we honor three of our amazing TV production students, Jonathan Ibarra, Drew Jones, and Rubaiyat Rhidoy, for earning honorable mention in this year's Studentcam C-SPAN video competition. Through their 3 years in TV production, these students have created incredible video programs, won several Skills USA awards at the district and state levels, and have initiated a long-term video documentary honoring TC super athletes, the Lowes brothers. Yes, they have been very busy, but today they're taking a break and they are being honored themselves. At this point, I'd like to welcome Dr. Dingle to say a few words about these students.
Thank you. And good morning, everyone. Seriously? Okay. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
All right. So, you know, when I first came to TC, as I was doing my homework, I'm looking and reading about, you know, T.C. Williams High School. You know, the first thing you hear about or you read about is Remember the Titans. So that's like one of the first things. And as I started digging deeper, I started, you know, going into websites and looking at our website and finding out about the teachers and the students and some of the incredible things that happen in this building. I'm thinking, wow, is that really for real? Do these things happen at a high school? I'm now here, and I get to see firsthand some of the incredible things that our students do here at T.C. Williams High School. These guys have done an amazing job here, what they've done in this particular contest. When you think about what they accomplished and all the work they put into this endeavor, folks, I can tell you, I said this to my PTA last night, this is my second state, my third high school, various roads along the way. This is the first place I've ever been where I've been exposed to such incredible students and teachers and community. I mean, the list just goes on and on in terms of the ways that our community supports our students to go on and do great things. And we get to sit Let me tell you a little bit about this competition. And again, to C-SPAN, thank you first and foremost for this opportunity. Again, an incredible opportunity for these guys to participate. So the theme for this year, 2016, was Road to the White House. What's the issue you want most candidates to discuss during the 2016 presidential campaign? Wow. Given this particular campaign, that's a wide open door. Lots of different things, hot button issues out there today. So there are over 2,887 entries from almost 6,000 students in 45 states, including here in Washington, D.C., Alexandria. Now, of those 6,000 students and all those entries, there are only 150 winners. So this puts these guys in an elite company, a really incredible feat that they accomplished here. So their entry was entitled The Cost of Justice, and it talks about for-profit prisons. Now, most of us think about prisons being nonprofits. This is, they did work on a for-profit prison. Can't wait to see it, by the way. Sounds really interesting. So let's talk a little bit about who these guys are. First, Jonathan Ibarra. Jonathan, stand up for just a moment. As he said before, he's a senior. He's been in this television production program for 3 years. Now, once he leaves here, these hallowed halls of T.C. Williams High School, he's going to George Mason, where unfortunately he's going to be majoring in IT instead of media. But Jonathan, congratulations, sir. Thank you. Andrew, stand up, please, sir. Andrew is also a senior. He's been also in TV production for 3 years. He's going to Virginia Tech, and he's going to be pursuing a career in broadcast and journalism. So congratulations and job well done. Thank you, sir. And last but not least, Rubaiyat Rhidoy, thank you, also a senior, has been in the program also for 3 years, has been accepted into George Mason. We go to Nova for 2 years, and then we'll pursue a career in film and media. So again, congratulations and thank you as well, sir. So a couple weeks ago, actually almost a month ago, we had this small figure come in, Jane Goodall, you know, just local celebrity. She's done a lot of work, also a lot of with films and primates. As I think about her career and what she's accomplished, and I don't mean I'm being totally serious, I think about the opportunities that you all have. You have started something, a very small endeavor. I can see down the road you all having similar fame, and I truly mean that. As I had caught a snippet of what you've done and heard more about what you've done, this is good work. It's been recognized by C-SPAN as well. So my challenge to you, you've already laid some good groundwork. Continue to build upon that groundwork and do great things and represent us well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jingle. At this point, I would like to ask Ms. Vanessa Torres of C-SPAN to come up.
Awesome, Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Jinko, for talking about the competition. It's such a great competition that C-SPAN holds every year. It's been around for about 12 years, so definitely watch out for the new topic that's coming out this hopefully by the end of July, beginning of August, for upcoming juniors and seniors and all that good stuff. But we definitely thank you guys for competing in the competition. As Dr. Jingle said, it is, you know, a nationwide documentary contest. We only choose 150 winners, and we visited all the winners across the entire country. So far, I think we've gone to about 145 schools nationwide, so it's been fun for us to be traveling with the C-SPAN bus. So usually that is here with us. That's what I usually work on, but unfortunately, it's in the Maryland area. But I want to definitely give you guys some recognition from C-SPAN. So our founder, Brian Lamb, and our co-CEO, Susan Swain, have given you guys certificates. So I'm going to have you all come up front so I can hand these over to you. So, and we'll take some pictures later. So I have Jonathan. Congratulations.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Drew. Congratulations. And Rubaiyat.
Yep.
Congratulations. And a round of applause for them, guys. Awesome. So I always like to embarrass the students a little bit, kind of catch them off guard, just a tiny bit. We always just love to kind of get their insight on why they chose the topic, how it was working together. Because as seniors, I'm sure when I was a senior, I was pretty busy, definitely during the springtime, just kind of excited to go off to school and go on to new adventures. So I definitely would like to know, and just to share with everyone, what it was like working together, what made you choose your topic, and what was the most difficult part about your video and just all that. So anybody can answer her.
Oh wow.
I know, right? You can come up here if you'd like.
Okay. Well, as far as the topic, it was something I had heard very little about, but it's something I had heard of, and I thought it was an issue that sounded kind of frightening, to be honest, and I thought it needed more attention. And as far as working together, we work together a lot in class, and it's a lot of fun, and I think we make a good team.
Good.
And I guess the hardest part would be, it's intimidating to go to an actual prison and film in kind of a bad neighborhood, I guess. But it was worth it. I think I'm really proud of what we did and what everyone has done on the team.
Were people, when you reached out to different folks, like interview or even just the prison, were they accepting of you guys coming in or asking questions, or did you get pushback? Because we have a lot of students that will try to get interviews, and it's hard sometimes because, you know, there's different people that they try to get, and sometimes C-SPAN can't even get, and then you see in the students' videos that they were able to get it. We're like, oh, that's so cool, but we just always like to hear.
Well, we tried to reach out to them to possibly get actually inside the prison and get an interview. We did not get a response for some reason. So we ended up having to only film from public property, from the sidewalks.
Gotcha. Okay.
Some of the people there kind of bothered us a little bit. They didn't want us around because as an institution, it's pretty much generally accepted that for-profit is not the best solution to the overcrowding problem in prisons.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
So they pretty much figured it was going to be negative coverage, I think.
Oh.
But it worked out. We got what we needed, I guess.
That's good. Yeah, it's always fun because we'll always talk to different students, and they'll always say what how it was going, you know, talking to people, and they kind of get negative responses. But it's always, that's what's the interesting part about C-SPAN, is sometimes you're going to talk to people that are for what you're talking about or against it, which is always really interesting. So congratulations to you guys, and I think now we're going to go ahead and watch the video, I believe. So for those of you that haven't been able to watch it, we'll go ahead and watch it now. And everything's available on studentcam.org, so to get additional information for upcoming the new topics and just to check it out and share it with friends and all that good stuff. So congratulations, you guys, and everybody at the education team and C-SPAN really congratulate you. And we're excited to see what you guys have in store next. And then definitely look at C-SPAN for internships. We have really great ones. I started there as an intern, so I always like to say you guys should come over. But it's always really fun. So thank you guys so much and congratulations.
Thank you.
Congrats.
Thank you.
You're welcome. And thank you all so much for having me. So we're going to have to watch the video now.
Have you ever heard of a for-profit prison?
No, I've not heard of a for-profit prison.
No.
No, not really.
Yeah. I mean, I've heard of a private prison.
No, I haven't.
Yes.
Yeah, I think so.
No, I can't say I have.
No.
I have not.
No.
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 No, I haven't. No.
No, I have not.
The for-profit prison industry has grown in size and power while remaining in relative obscurity. These companies are making a combined $3.3 billion in annual revenue and are funneling millions of it to candidates and millions more into lobbying efforts. Despite all this money, the vast majority of Americans fail to even recognize the term. This has caused the Washington Post to call the industry the biggest lobby no one is talking about. Recently, questions have been raised about the industry's treatment of prisoners and whether or not the mostly nonviolent offenders that make up the majority of these prisons' populations deserve to be incarcerated at all. When the justice system is turned over to these corporations, they do what any other corporation does, and they try and increase their profits any way they can. They make money through huge government contracts that pay per prisoner, so they benefit from having more people imprisoned longer. These contracts also include lockup quotas that often guarantee 90 to 100% occupancy and force the government to either pay for empty beds or scramble to arrest enough people to fill them. The industry has spent millions getting legislation through Congress using politicians such as current Florida Senator and Republican presidential candidate Marco Rubio. Some of the laws they support include California's controversial three strikes law and the Arizona anti-illegal immigration law that sparked a huge racial profiling battle. The CCA, which operates this prison behind me, has openly stated that leniency in conviction or parole standards would hurt their bottom line. In a recent scandal the media has called Cash for Kids, a Pennsylvania judge has been sentenced to 28 years in prison for accepting bribes from a private prison company to give juvenile delinquents unusually long sentences. These companies obviously benefit too much from criminal punishment.
I would think the most important issue with a for-profit prison is if you've got a system of business that's based on nothing but the incarceration of human beings, American citizens, then the focus is not going to be on rehabilitation, but how can I stack as many people as possible into that prison?
Well, number one, where are they getting the money from?
And the government.
Okay. Well, where's the government getting the money from?
The taxpayer.
So my money.
Yes, it is your
money. Okay, so I have an issue with that. Number one, potential problems, the ethical standards for it. For profit, it's the same thing, the reason why McDonald's has a dollar menu. You bring people in, you entice them to come in, or any store that has a sale, you bring them in, you try and keep them in there as long as possible so they spend the most amount of money.
It just seems like you're throwing random people in jail just so you can make more money.
Yes, I mean, it puts more power in the hands of corporations.
I think for-profit prisons really just open up corruption at all the levels in the prison, in the government, and it's just not good for our society as a whole. Prisons should be run for the benefit of society rather than for-profit, because their real purpose is to make the people who committed crimes, who are bad people, and turn them back into people that can function in society, and for-profit prisons don't do that.
My name is Chris Golden. I teach criminal justice here at T.C. Williams High School now. Before this job, I was employed as a deputy sheriff in Alexandria from September of 1988 until December of 1994.
What are some potential concerns you have with for-profit versus regular?
I think the issue with for-profit facilities is that those prisons are run by a chief executive officer or a person whose highest priority is going to be to please the stakeholders and the stockholders, the shareholders. Our local jails in the state of Virginia are run by sheriffs who are publicly elected officials. And if they want to be reelected in the next term, then they know they have to answer to the public. I don't see that being the case with for-profit prisons, and I just believe that the opportunity to exploit and to take advantage of and to do real harm to the people on the inside is greater in a for-profit institution than one that is run by the government.
I'm Andrew Rozelle, and I teach AP government.
What are some big concerns with for-profit prisons?
I would say that the biggest concern with for-profit prisons is that it creates some perverse incentives as far as the number of people that are getting locked up, the length at which they're getting locked up in prison, and then some of the decisions that they're making as far as the way that we treat people that are in prison. It's not well known, but what you'll find is that some of the owners of the largest for-profit prisons do a lot of lobbying, that they are spending millions of dollars each year to convince members of Congress or state legislatures to pass policies as far as minimum sentencing laws to make sure that more people are ending up in prison.
What do you think the public should know about these?
As far as what the public should know, I think just being aware. I think it is starting to make it on the policy agenda a little bit in this country. Some specific members of Congress are starting to raise this issue. Orange is the New Black, for example, just brought this topic up in the last season, and I think a lot of Americans were watching that for, you know, comedic value or entertainment value and learned a little bit about, you know, some of the problems associated with these policies.
Kids are meant to sleep on cement beds. They are treated like animals. They are made to feel like they are not humans. A detainee had come to her and showed her the food that they were eating, and when the food opened up in a napkin in this person's hand, there were live maggots.
I am shocked to hear the consistency among different facilities we talked about today.
You may be wondering why anyone would support the idea of a for-profit prison. The answer is the prisoners are expensive. More money is being spent per prisoner than per student in every state. These companies market themselves as a cheaper and more efficient alternative to government-run prisons, and in some cases this might be true. However, studies have called this claim at best inconclusive. According to a U.S. Bureau of Justice Statistics study, the promised cost savings have simply not materialized. And even if this approach is cheaper, what is the moral cost of keeping these facilities open?
Earlier, we love to acknowledge the students by inviting local and national elected officials. So your mayor was able to stop by. Now we have your local, your congressman. So office, they sent a staffer over. So we have Phil. So if Phil could come up on behalf of Congressman Beyer's office. So.
Good morning. Good morning, everyone. I want to keep this extremely short. But on behalf of the congressman and his office, we are so very proud of you. I watched the video yesterday, and when I was watching it, my coworkers were walking by, and I was just like, oh, what? It was incredible. It was for-profit jails and prisons. You know, there's not much attention paid to it, so the fact that you guys have brought it to a national attention, I'm very proud. We're very proud and honored that you are our constituents, and we couldn't be more happy. I wish you the best in your futures. You guys have a great path ahead of you. I'm looking forward to seeing much more from you guys. This is definitely not the last time that we see you guys. So on behalf of the congressman, I would like to present you three with certificates that pretty much just say, it's a certificate of achievement. This acknowledges that Jonathan, Drew, and Rubaiyat has been recognized for honorable mention in C-SPAN Studentcam 2016 for the cost of justice, signed by Donald Beyer Jr. This is May 24th.
So that's it for us. We just would like to thank T.C. Williams for having us here today and to Vilma for always being such a great teacher advisor for us. We really rely. Yes, a round of applause for her. I know I've worked with her for a few years, and we really Everybody always says such great things about Vilma and what she does locally for the students. So we really hope to see some more entries coming up from her next year. So thank you all again, and we hope to be back. So thank you.
Thank you very much for those kind words. Congratulations again to our amazing TV production students, Jonathan Ibarra, Drew Jones, and Rubaiyat Rhidoy. We'd also like to thank C-SPAN for giving high school students across the nation the opportunity to show their talents and compete amongst their peers. Thank you all for coming, and please enjoy some refreshments.